to Art Talk. I'm Patricia Shippee, your host of Through the Eyes of the Artist, a program focusing on the artist and the creative process from a human perspective to help us understand the attitudes and motivations of the artist, to see our world through the eyes of the artist. Our guest artist today is Tatiana Nekrasova, a young woman who came to America 3 years ago. Born in Moscow, Tanya attended the Moscow Art School for 6 years, and then the prestigious St. Stroganov Art Institute in Moscow for 5 years, earning a degree in fine art and graphic design. Since September, Tanya has been an artist in residence at the Griffis Art Center in New London, Connecticut, where she's had an opportunity to live and work in an environment that encourages concentrated time to focus on her work and its development. Hello, Tanya. Welcome Hello. To Art Talk.
Thank you. Patricia.
It's nice to have you here. Tanya, first question is, why did you come to America?
Because America is America. And for everybody who lives in another world, in Europe or in Russia, it's a very interesting new planet because it's so different, it's so amazing, and it's a new continent. And mm-hmm. so progressive country.
So you read about it, you hear about it, you see television, I guess.
Of course. And in Russia, America, it's something like a fairy tale, because if we compare that level of life and how people live here, so of course everybody dreamed to look, what is it, America?
Mm-hmm. So you had an opportunity through, is it a great aunt of yours to come here?
Yes, my grand aunt, she came here after, during last war, mm-hmm. and 1942, and she invited me to visit her for 3 months, and I stay here for 3 years.
Fantastic.
Thanks for her. Thanks her. How do you say in
yes,
English?
Yes, thanks for her.
Thanks for her. I'm here, and I'm trying to learn many new things, mm-hmm. which America shows me every day.
Yes, I'm sure of that. Well, Tanya, when I was reading about you, you are credited with 11 years of art schooling.
Yes.
That's an awful lot of art schooling. I mean, what are Russian art schools about? Is it difficult to get into an art academy? How does it work?
In former Soviet Union, in Russia, of course, we have absolutely different system of education, because the school program is about 10 years old, I don't know, in America, maybe the same thing, 10 years old, like school program, not school program, high school.
High school is 3 or 4 years in the States. So was the Moscow Institute like our high school?
No, it's when the little children, until 7 years, they're in a special children house when they growing up, and when they
learning to read and count,
yes. Yeah. And then after that, they go to the regular school. Mm-hmm. When the educational program takes about 10 years, not about, just 10 years.
Yeah, yeah.
And after that, the people, the teenagers,
yes,
how we can
yes,
call them,
yes.
They are 16 years old. They can, if they want, to pass exam in some institute, or I don't know, in America you call it high school?
Yes.
High school,
yes.
Okay.
But you had to fulfill certain requirements to go to the schools you went to, mean, you had to take exams and you had to show a facility for drawing? Or?
After, when you are 6 years old, you just go in a regular school, like in America. But then, yes, if you want to pass exam, if you want to be a student of some institute, you have to pass exam. And believe me, that it's very difficult to pass exam.
To be chosen for one of these schools.
Yes, and some people even trying to pass that exam many years, few years.
Ah.
Yes, it's very difficult. You have to be prepared perfect.
So you had to study a lot, but you wanted to study art. I mean, the institute you chose was an art institute.
Yes, because in Russia, there institutes, or how do you call it, schools.
Yeah.
They have special every institute have special subjects.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, like art institute or architectural institute.
But you knew you wanted to study art. I mean, you knew that as a
Yes, I knew it since my childhood.
Okay, well, that's a very
important
factor.
That I will be
an
artist.
Yeah, yeah. Well, what do you think your schooling has meant to you in the development of your work?
A lot of it for me. It was a very important time because I grew up with my friends who, and we have some competence. No, how to say
competitions yes,
between
yes.
each other, and it helped a lot. We had special teachers who taught us. Every day with new interesting things, and I think that the level of education in Russia, it's on a very high level.
Is it? It's
yes.
It's extraordinary.
Yes.
It sounds like it must be.
Yes.
Well, Tanya, I think this might be a good time for us to bring our viewers over to your studio and look at some of the paintings right there. So
Great.
Why don't we do that now?
Thank you.
We're entering the studio at the Griffis Art Center where Tanya works and giving you a short glimpse of several of her paintings that recall her Russian homeland. These are sensitive paintings filled with nostalgia and her own feelings about Russian life, the environment in which she lived. You can easily discern the seasons in each painting. The cold and gray moods, or the warmth of the sun reflecting on water, and sometimes casting shadows on the imposing and grand architecture. One's imagination can almost hear Russian music in the background, and possibly classical ballet dancers floating through these quiet and romantic scenes. You can see Tanya's skill in depicting details of realism in her landscapes, especially the delicate watercolors. Remember that Tanya trained as a graphic artist, so her attention to detail is quite evident in all of these paintings. We're here in Tanya's studio space, where she is going to let us observe her actually painting. And we're going to see the latest painting that she's been working on, which is a very interesting combination of Russian iconography, architecture, certainly history, these people that she often intersperses as a surprise in many of her paintings, which are lined up here in almost a surrealist way. Tanya, you've got everything going on here. You've got precise realism, and you have lots of abstraction, and the techniques you've used, there are so many different techniques. What are the materials you've used in this painting?
This is, how to say it in English, mixing.
Yes.
Mixing
mixed
of
media.
Mixed media with acrylic and oil. So that's I began to paint with acrylic, and thanks to acrylic,
I reached that interesting texture of lines and strokes of brushes, and then oil helped me to put some details like the figure, or to play with that interesting form of the texture of which acrylic made.
Well, this almost looks like watercolor in the center there, because it it looks as if you've actually dripped water on the painting. Is that watercolor or acrylic?
Acrylic is, we can call it watercolor, because you can paint acrylic only with water. That's why we can call it watercolor. And so I knew my idea before, and I even knew how it goes, but that interesting method of dropping colors with brushes, or even you can take, for example, this little dishes with colors, and you can the colors falls on the canvas and create interesting pools, even pools of colors.
But you did that, I would imagine, on the floor.
Oh yes, I mean, yes,
not
yes,
while
yes.
Painting was, okay,
exactly,
okay.
And. It's interesting that you sometimes you cannot predict what will happen. For example, that horse jumped through some space. We can see it's like a little hole in space.
Yes.
It was created by accident, because it was a pool of colors. Then I let it dry, and now we can see very strange texture, and I put the horse. So you see that the heroes of the picture painting will go through very strange and accidentally forms, and that's why for me it's a very interesting new method how I can create my painting.
So you would just sort of drop that color onto the canvas and let it dry however it wants to dry?
Yes, and then, for example, you see that little burn stains?
Yes, yeah.
It was accidentally too, and it makes the painting more mystery for me, and I know why I know exactly the purpose of the burn stuff, but before I even didn't know that it will come.
What is the purpose?
Mystery. The life is mystery,
and
that's why so strange, different things here. We can see a very realistic thing, but suddenly that material transform in another material. Like you see that little lines or drops, and I don't know. For me. The material is always transformed to another to another thing. It's alive.
Well, was this the first time you've experimented with acrylic paints in this way?
Yes, exactly.
But you've used
in
acrylic.
In the Griffis Art Center, I found
you,
it.
You experimented and it happened for you. It's very exciting.
Exactly. For me, it's something new.
Yes. Well, now, Tanya, I would like you to tell us what is going on in this painting, too. Is there a story here? I mean, it's obviously Russia. I mean, the onion domes, the cathedral. But who are all these people, and what do they mean to you, and what should they mean to me?
Okay, exactly. A very good question. What does it mean to you? Because, how do you say in English, people who look at the picture.
Yes.
I'm
the
artist.
Viewer.
The viewer. The viewers. Because I thought what difference between artist and viewer? I think that only one difference that artists know how to draw. But they have the same
feelings, emotions.
Feelings, emotions about what do they see, and I try to understand how to find how to find that point, that view when people look at my painting and they could understand me, or even if they cannot understand, maybe they can find some deep idea, or even to create by themselves. And that's why I appreciate you for your question. What does it mean for you?
Uh-huh.
Like for me?
Well, let's take a tour of the painting, if you will. I mean,
yes.
can we begin here with the dog? I mean,
okay.
What does he mean to you? I mean, he's guarding this whole thing.
I just love dogs. But the idea was and is the line.
Yes.
Of people, things,
a journey
of everything, the line, and what is it line? Because we are our life, it is line. So mm-hmm. we are on our place, and everybody has
road,
his place,
a road,
exactly.
Or a journey.
Yes,
I mean,
exactly.
That's what, here is a journey almost of history. Like a Madonna is here.
Yes, and she is among that people who, and even things who are in the line. And I just put this line in a Russian topic, because I'm Russian, and
yes,
I continue
yes.
to
well.
Think about my country.
Mm-hmm.
We can put that line in any condition, in any
mm-hmm.
in any country or landscapes. We can put it in the desert or in the space. Or
sure.
And
but you've placed it within Russian.
For me, it's Russian landscape. For
yeah,
me,
yeah.
that place for that line, Russian landscape. This is Cathedral of Saint Basil, which is on the Red Square in Moscow.
Uh-huh.
And
which
I always
all the time.
It's amazing cathedral. It's every Russian proud of it. That's why I put it in the center and the line goes around it.
Yes.
And there, and in the background we can see Moscow, like
the city of Moscow.
Yes.
Well, and then there's the red carpet. What is the meaning of the red carpet?
It's just no meaning.
Okay.
A spot.
It's red.
A spot.
It's color. Okay, now can you show us a little bit? You've got your paint set up here, lots of color. How you actually apply the paint? I think we'd be interested in seeing that.
Yes, I just I don't know exactly how it goes right now, because you know it takes idea.
Yeah.
Because it's very
yeah.
difficult just. But for example, if we put even this sponge, okay, in the water.
Yeah,
and then because the sponge has a texture, special texture of the surface.
Yes.
Surface, or how
yes.
you say?
Yeah.
And even put it like here, okay, and then we can just how's it? How do you say in English that verb when you
press?
Press it. Yeah.
Yes.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
And if we will turn it like this. Like this, you see. Immediately, we can see some effects. For example, now, what do I see now? Now I see maybe some fields through the window of aeroplane, or this is the river, or we can see the portrait of some lady. With her,
these are abstract forms.
Exactly, with your neck or face and
uh-huh.
her hair,
uh-huh.
and you can play with this. You can you can create interesting things.
Indeed. But
which
also,
you never expect before.
Yes, but with your sense of draftsmanship and your fine draftsmanship, this is a whole new opening for you.
Yes, exactly. That's what I'm trying to do, and that's what Patricia I wanted to say to you, that for me now this period when I'm living in a Griffis Art Center, it's a researching time of some material things, why this things or that thing better than another, why exactly, how to paint, and to find that method how to create things it will open for me the gates for the new kingdom. Because
for experimenting.
Because we have two problems. We have two problems. One problem, what to paint or to draw. Another question is how to paint.
Mm-hmm.
What to draw, it's very, you have, it takes a long time maybe to think about the idea, but maybe most important thing, how to do it, how to make it.
Uh-huh. Well, in the case of this painting, you had an idea first with the Russian architecture. St. Basil, was it?
Yes, because before I paint a lot Russian landscapes.
So you began with your Russian homeland, what you knew, how to draw architectural forms. And then you began to play with it.
Exactly, because before I will show you my Russian landscapes, when I had my own method with that Russian landscape. Mm-hmm. So now I'm trying to find another way to paint and to create things.
Okay. Well, Tanya, we're going to go backwards then. We're going to let you alone to work on this painting some more because it's not finished.
Exactly.
I'm waiting to see what else you do with it. And then we'll come back again in a few minutes and you can take us through where you began and then where you're going. Let's do that.
Okay. Okay. And I will begin to paint the sky. Because if you will see at my sky, you immediately can see difference.
Yes.
I have. Uh-huh. It's necessary to finish.
And did you do the water spotting on the sky first?
Yes, but I didn't how to drop it. I painted with a brush and I
loosely.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So here. Now we have a very rich
surface
exactly,
yes.
to make it more not so flat.
Okay.
I'm sorry, my English.
That you're doing very well, Tanya. Well, there's I can see, I'm not sure the camera can see, there's a lot of texture on the canvas already from the paint you've applied. And now you're going to apply more acrylic paint, so there will be even more texture to the surface.
Yes, and it will help the clouds, for example, to come toward us.
Uh-huh.
Like,
yes.
If I will put little white, we can see how it's I don't know in a good
it's
word.
It's coming forward. Yes.
Exactly.
Yes. Yeah.
That's why I even made some pictures. I always look at the sky. For me, sky, it's another create palette.
That's true. And in each of your paintings, you give us the feeling of sunlight, mostly. The time of day you're depicting with your skies. The feeling of the day, the weather of the day. This is going to be a very interesting day because of all that's going on
yes,
in the
turbulent,
painting.
Yes, turbulent, exactly.
Yeah, yeah. Well, often the skies in Russia were turbulent, I would think.
And Patricia, it's very difficult to explain, maybe you'll not understand, but the American sky much lower than Russian. Russian sky, you don't see where the moon, you don't see the clouds so far away that...
Even
here
though
you can touch clouds.
Really?
Yes.
Really? Even though your cathedrals and the architecture, it seems to me, reaches the sky. No? No.
Yes and no. Yes and no. I just only notice one thing, that American sky is much lower. Maybe it's because it depends on ocean or some water climate, or I don't know how to say.
Yeah.
But especially San Francisco. Can touch the turbulent clouds.
Wow.
It's beautiful, and for me it's very unusual.
Okay, well let's let you finish this painting, Tanya, and
yes.
We're going to take a break while you do that, and then you're going to hopefully walk us through some of your other work here today.
Okay, thank you, Patricia.
Well, Tanya, that was fascinating. I noticed that many of your recent paintings are much larger. Do you think, since you've been here, there's been a lot of changes in your work? Do you find you working in larger scale, different colors and technique? How has your work changed since you've been here?
Of course, Patricia, it changed a lot. And you could see some of my paintings which I made before even Griffis Art Center, when I just only came in. It was very realistic landscape, calm topic and colors. And so then, little by little, I was changing. It's difficult to explain why. And then I began to paint some abstract things. Mm-hmm. And now I'm painting that huge size of little sewer. But of course, I continue to use realistic base painting.
But you're changing techniques too. You're experimenting with all sorts of techniques now.
Yes, and America opened for me many new things about me, about myself, and I even don't know what is it. Maybe it's some sides of what people call freedom, because I let me go in some direction, and I don't think am I right or not. That's I want to do now, and this is my new experiments, and I don't afraid anymore. I don't have any levels.
You're looking at the world through freer eyes, really.
Yes, yeah, yes, yeah. And that's what's happened with me in America.
Uh-huh. Well, that's very exciting, Tanya.
Thank you.
Well, now, a question I have is, for each painter is different, but do you have a ritual each day? Do you start to work at a particular time each day and arrange your studio? Or how does each day begin painting for you?
First, I make some tea. For me,
tea.
And some tea, yes.
Okay.
I don't drink coffee a lot. Mm-hmm. And then about 3-4 o'clock, I go to the studio.
In the afternoon.
Yes, in the afternoon, and as usual, I'm working in the evening time. So mm-hmm. maybe I'm night bird.
Yes, yes.
And that's why that's our life in Griffis Art Center. Opened for me a great opportunity to be free, not only with my feelings and thoughts, but with my time. It's very important too. Mm-hmm.
So you use these chunks of time to really develop your work. Well, I could see it in the studio.
Yes.
Well, now when you go into the studio and you have a blank canvas in front of you, how do you begin with it? With an idea, a dream, a color in your mind? How do you begin?
I have the painting already in my head, and I try to keep it during my painting, during my work, mm-hmm. when I'm working with the canvas. So I know before start what I want to reach with this canvas.
Mm-hmm.
So I have a slide. In
yes,
the head.
Yes, a slide. That's
which
good.
Which I try to reach.
A visual image or a slide, and
yes.
then you work it through.
Yes, and but sometimes some new shapes appear in the canvas,
mm-hmm.
But it's only it doesn't destroy my idea and that slide which I had before.
Yeah. Well, that's a good way to put it, the slide.
Yes.
Well, going back to Russia again and the art schooling, was the subject matter or the content of the paintings dictated to you?
In Russia?
Yeah.
I can say yes. And it was, even it was a big problem for the Soviet artists,
mm-hmm.
not particularly for me, but it was a big problem for all Soviet art in that time, because we had two two directions of how Soviet art was developing. Mm-hmm. It, we had official art and unofficial art. I'm sorry,
yeah,
my English.
Yeah. Your English is great.
Official art just described some things like collectivization firms or some events in political life mm-hmm. of country, and mm-hmm. that's how artists could make some bread with mm-hmm. this. Mm-hmm. To make some free things, creative things, it was even sometimes dangerous because you could lose your if you're a member of some union, you could lose that place. And
that's a question. What about artists' unions? That ties in. How do artists' unions work? Were you a member of an artists' union?
Before then, I came in America. I tried to go through the special commission because if you're an artist, if you finish some art institute, so you are a fine artist, mm-hmm. free artist. So to find some orders to make bread and to have exhibitions, you can only if you was a member of some union of
yes.
artists in
mm-hmm.
Russia,
yeah.
which provide people, artists with some orders with some circle of people who could help you mm-hmm. To continue your art life and everything. Mm-hmm. For the young people, it was the Union of Youth uh-huh. Uh-huh. of Soviet artists, young generation. And then the next step, it was Union of Moscow or Leningrad or doesn't matter, any cities of Russia, mm-hmm. unions. Mm-hmm. And so after that, if you're a member of the Moscow Union of Artists,
yeah.
And if you even have some...
awards or...
Awards, exactly,
okay.
awards. Mm-hmm. So the highest level of that step is academic
mm-hmm.
when you are becoming academic
yeah.
and the academic even has the salary every month
oh.
and special demands
mm-hmm.
Then the member of that union they can spend their summertime in the special houses of
studios,
mm-hmm, art, mm-hmm. art centers.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So it's just provide you with everything.
Steady income, a place to
and
work.
And the exhibitions, and so it was very important, exhibitions.
Yeah, yeah.
Because here, when I came here, I made already two exhibitions here.
Yeah.
So that's what was absolutely impossible in Russia, uh-huh. if you are not a member of some organization.
Yes, I wonder, well, what if you're not a member of a union in Russia? You can't show your work, and
it was incredible. I mean, it was impossible. Sorry,
yeah.
it was
yeah.
impossible.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
and so some galleries or opportunities like this we had not. That's mm-hmm. why it was very limited mm-hmm. Circle of people who could create, who could have some orders.
Yeah.
And it was another side of life. An unofficial art,
mm-hmm.
when people
mm-hmm.
could make
whatever they wanted to.
People
yeah.
Who made the choice.
Yeah,
I'm artist and mm-hmm. I'm mm-hmm. making my children my paintings, mm-hmm. even if nobody will have interest mm-hmm. or mm-hmm. if the government doesn't like it.
Yeah, but economically, I mean, it's very difficult.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
it's like to be an artist in Soviet Union. Mm-hmm. 10 years ago, 5 years ago, it was like a Hamlet question, to be or not to be, there or here.
Well, good for you, Tanya.
Oh, yeah.
Well, Tanya, I noticed in your studio that you seem to be able to work on several different projects and several different styles of work at the very same time. So I'd like to go back to your studio now and look at some of the other things that you've done.
Good, great.
Tanya has yet another talent, and that is a very traditional Russian art form of wood painted Easter eggs. So tell us about the Easter eggs, Tanya.
Okay, you see that here is the Easter eggs, the special religious objects for Easter time. Mm-hmm. And in Russia it's very important event because a lot of people, Orthodox or Christian. Mm-hmm. Easter in Russian we call it Pascha. So everybody, a lot of people prepare themselves to the Pascha. And when I am painting the eggs, I can make some money before Easter time. And exactly right now, this is before Easter, and that's why I made already a few of them, and I will show you my instruments like this very finest brush. I have my glasses,
which you need for such fine detail. Well, can you just go buy a wooden Easter egg? Is that where you begin? You buy an egg. You buy a wooden oval piece.
I'm going to just simple wood store, and I'm buying a wood egg, mm-hmm. and then covered with any color, like
a background, like you would do a canvas. Lay a background.
Exactly.
Okay.
Or icon. Before you begin to paint, you will cover with something. Mm-hmm. And
then the detail begins. So then you begin to work so finely.
Yes, and then I will put some design with my pencil, and I will begin to paint with finest.
Put it here. Show me here.
Sanis brush. Yeah. Little very. Uh-huh. You see that the, this is the topic fairy tale, Russian fairy tale. Mm-hmm. The firebird, Zhar Ptitsa, we call it in Russian, Zhar Ptitsa.
Yes.
It makes a lot of burn or heart.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how. I'm sorry, my English.
And large wings, and it's a very elaborate bird. And this is a very elaborate egg, and the subject is elaborate. And then you have another subject here, Tanya, which is architecture.
Yes, and this is the Moscow landscape.
Mm-hmm.
You can see how many little towers and houses, buildings. It's like Moscow was looked like 100 years ago.
So for you, it's very nostalgic.
Oh yes, and I always remember Russia when I'm painting.
I'm sure you do, and what painstaking work. Now this one is for you. I think perhaps the one here of St. Mark, there's one of St. Mark and St. Stephen. Is this something a person would ask you to do? Is this something that would be commissioned?
Yes, there are two eggs. It's an order from one man, but there. Yes, the eggs for only for the picture of some saints.
I see.
Here we can see Saint Mark, mm-hmm. and Saint mm-hmm. Stephen, but the background of the Stephen picture here, mm-hmm. some design,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and people like it, and that's why they call it Easter egg. They buy it before Easter time, and
Well, this harkens back to your graphic design talent, doesn't it? Being a graphic designer.
I like to make delicate things.
Drawings.
Yes, exactly.
But then, Tanya, going on to another talent, you go from delicate drawings and very fine, realistic drawings to some of the newer paintings you've done here. Mm. So, this is not a delicate drawing. I'm
going to
change places with you.
Yes,
so you can describe this. I want you to tell me and the audience about this painting first, and then we'll move to some of the other ones. This is so different.
And this is New London. New London in winter time. Because when I came in America, the first winter time, it was in New London. And I was surprised about the colors, because you can see here that green light,
yes,
and how it mixes with white, mm-hmm, and the train station, and some part of New London streets.
Oh, now I see here. I don't know if the Bank Street,
or
yes,
that cathedral across, uh-huh, our street.
Uh-huh.
And
uh-huh,
I was wondering how it was possible when you see the green bushes in the winter time.
Oh,
so for me, it was my first meeting with some of strange things for me, for mm-hmm, me, only mm-hmm, for me in mm-hmm, America.
So I see here there's a lighthouse, and this is one of the monuments here in the city of New London.
Yeah, this is my favorite train station, because yeah, I traveled a lot. And
yeah.
I put it on my canvas with pleasure. I like that building, and that building very old.
Uh-huh, uh-huh, yes, and it is. It's a very important building here.
Exactly, and we can see here some sheep and some of New London streets, mm-hmm, little shops, and I put some bird here because I just want to repeat that the winter in America is a very strange mixing, because in
and
Russia, as usual, only white color everywhere.
I
snow.
See. Yeah. So you've got the green and the whites. You have a lot of movement here, and you've got a lot of edges here. Now, can we go to the next painting, where I don't see edges. I see lots of flowing lines. Now, where and when did you do this painting? Was this done at the Griffis Art Center?
Yes, I painted. I began.
Can
I
you
began
get a little closer, Tanya? So
yes, I began it before, and I finished it here. The name of the painting is Gossip.
So great name. Okay.
Here you can see the ear cave, some features of people who are trying to look what is going
on inside. Okay.
Some man who can hold the horse, who can hold the sheep, and some man who cannot hold his tonga when sometimes we're talking bad things, and it's so difficult to stop. That's what gossip is.
Yes, yes. Well, I'm not sure if the camera's been able to get into this. Come over this side, Tanya,
okay,
because you've talked about, but I'm not sure that the camera was able to see. You discover these people that are sitting around the form of the ear.
And you see that even we have three marmots. In Russian we call it rusalka, the women who lives
in the sea. Yeah.
And also they try to understand what is going on, what goes in that cave.
Okay, into the ear.
Into the ear.
And then who is this on the horse?
The horse, the man like a person, as a person who are very strong to hold the horse, the sheep, and to do a lot of beautiful things. But the problem, how to keep your talking. And for example, that man, it's like the snake, it's like a shape of gossip. And so, you know, it's sometimes very difficult to explain. I just felt that I can put something exactly that uh-huh, shapes in the canvas.
Well, this is part of your whole experimentation it's a new thing to you since you've been in America.
Yes,
so you're expressing
yes,
yourself.
That's how America helped me to feel that freedom in how to create things. When I create things, before I was very more close in my direction, like very realistic or something.
Yes,
I like
yes,
realism.
Well, here's realism, Tanya.
Yes.
Now here we see realism with some gaiety, some humor. Who is that man?
That man, it's my I don't know how to explain. This is my view on New London, on
okay,
America, if you want.
Okay.
It's so strange. So strange feature.
Yeah.
He's a cyclist, but he's using ancient bicycle.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the street of New London, which is very
so quiet.
It's quiet, exactly how New London is. Quiet enough city for me, because I'm from Moscow. Everybody is very turbulent and talking and noises. But that person in New London, for me, it's like a shape how it's strange for me, everything here, because I'm from another planet, another continent.
So the buildings are small to you. They're compared to your major cathedrals with domes and towers. These are short little buildings, and the sky shows.
Yes, I don't know, Peter, sometimes so difficult even to explain. Just felt that mood about New London, and a little strange, little interesting, and that's
but
how
I saw
it.
But very happy and lots of light. I like the idea that you've got so much light in it, Tanya.
Thank you.
Well, we don't have time to talk about everything that's here. We must go back to the TV station, which we'll do. But thank you for the visit to
your
studio.
Thank you very much.
We've enjoyed it. And
thank
we'll
you.
Go back to the TV station now.
Thank you. Thank you. See you soon.
Well, Tanya, working on those delicate Easter eggs requires such control and precision. And then you have this new concern with abstract forms. So you're working in different methods. Does changing from one to the other help you in your expression?
Yes. Well, I just even don't know how to explain it, because I'm not a calm person. And to change style, to change topic, it's my character. And maybe sometimes it bothers me to reach some
place.
Some things.
You need the energy change.
Yes,
for
yes,
your
because it's impossible to go only in one direction for me. So I have to change and to play with forms, with new colors, with a new size. So I can make one little small egg, and then huge canvas, so it's give me more energy. And
yes, I can see the change from one to the other would probably help balance you out.
Yes. That's what I began to work like this only maybe a few months ago. Before, I went in with one topic for a long time.
Always the same
yes.
direction. Well, that in terms of that now, Tatiana Nekrasova, how would you describe your work to a collector? That's all right.
How can I describe?
That's probably a difficult question.
Very difficult.
Because
school,
you're
yes.
changing so now.
It's like how I can describe myself when I introduce when I'm introducing to somebody.
Yeah.
It's very difficult. Just only we can look at the painting, and maybe they will describe
okay.
myself.
Yes. Well, that's a good way to put it. That really is. Well, also, you talked about one title of the painting, Gossip, and then I discovered that abstracted ear. How do you title your paintings? How does that happen for you?
I tried to concentrate the idea in one word, and
that is remarkable.
Because
in English.
Oh yes,
yes?
Thank you, thank you. Because I need understanding.
Yes. A definition for yourself, perhaps.
I need. People, when they look at the painting, sometimes they are lost themselves because so many new subjects for them, and
well, this
suddenly
is
they came from the streets and they thought about their problems. Yeah. So suddenly, the ear, the snake, the horse. What does it mean? So the name of paintings help a lot to understand.
Yes.
Or even not maybe to understand, but to touch the topic.
Yes,
what
yes.
I'm talking about.
And then to read the painting. Read it through your eyes, perhaps, as well as the viewer's
yes.
eyes. Well, what about this painting? I mean, if I didn't know the title of this painting, I would think about it as an abstracted, colorful, beautiful
something.
Drawing.
Something. But this is the head of the fish. And then you can see even
is the title. What is the title?
The hiding fish.
Hiding fish.
Hiding fish. Yes, because the head of the fish, which very difficult to find, maybe, but that was the idea, how some creatures adapt to the background or to some to some life, and it's a very interesting topic.
It is indeed.
It's a philosophy.
Yes. Well, do you think you'll follow that mode? Because this works so beautifully, Tanya.
Thank you. Yeah. I just try to make as much as I can, and sometimes maybe I don't reach my first idea and thoughts, yes, but that's only what I can do. Mm-hmm. I'm trying.
Mm-hmm. Well, speaking of trying, do you have an idea of where you might be going in your career as an artist? Do you think you're going to be able to seriously manage art and life? What do you think?
No, I don't think so.
No?
It's like Dali, for example, when somebody asked him about the price of his paintings,
yes,
he never could answer, and always he sent the people to his wife.
Oh.
Just ask Marina, her name was Marina, she was a Russian woman.
Yeah.
So I never can could understand selling and or how to value some painting. That's what your question was.
It's where do you want to go as an artist? I mean, do you plan to be an artist for your entire life and manage art and life?
Manage. What does it mean, manage? That's what was my problem.
To be able to live with.
To make some money with this.
Exactly.
You mean?
To
yes.
survive with your art. To be able to continue with your art.
To be or not to be, the
Again.
100 question. Very difficult to answer, very difficult, because everybody needs money and we want to have some good time. I think that it depends how it goes, mm-hmm. how are you feeling. And mm-hmm. of course, if you are, you have to work every day and you have to concentrate all your power and force
yes.
about it.
Yes.
So
yeah.
if you work, if you are busy with something else, you're yeah. losing time
yeah.
and
uh-huh.
your skill and ability mm-hmm. to do mm-hmm. something, to create something. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's a very difficult question, I think, for every
artist. I know it is, and I hope
yes.
it wasn't an unfair one. Well, Tanya, you eventually would like to teach art. What do you think would be the most important idea that you'd want to convey to your students?
You know, Patricia, I think that I never would be able to teach.
Ah, I thought that was one of your potential dreams.
I don't think so, because I'm feeling myself always like a student or mm-hmm. the researching mm-hmm. creature, mm-hmm. and for me, It could be very difficult. I could teach how to draw, just the beginning,
yes.
classic things. Mm-hmm. But to show people some creative things, how to be free with your painting. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure that I can do it
okay.
today.
Yeah.
Maybe in the future.
In the future.
Yes.
Well, Tanya, we've covered a lot, and I'm afraid we've run out of time. I have many more questions for you, so we'll do the questions later. But thank you very much for sharing with us today. And thank you for joining us for this week's Art Talk. Until next time, I'm Patricia Shippee.